Hi, this is State Senator Todd Kaminsky. Welcome everyone to the NCON Agriculture and Housing Subcommittee, the first of this year's 2021 budget season. Want to welcome first my Senate colleagues, and then I'll kick it over to our co-chair, Steve Englebright. First, I'd like to welcome Senator Michelle Hinchey, Chair of Agriculture Committee. Next, Senator Brian Kavanaugh, Chair of the Housing Committee. Senator Kevin Parker, the Chair of the Energy Committee. We have Zellner Myrie, who is our alternate captain. We have Senator Pam Helming, who's ranker on housing, and her alternate, Senator Dan Steck. To you, Chair Englebright.
Thank you, Senator. I'm very pleased to introduce Assemblymember Steve Simberwitz, the Chair of the Housing Committee, Assemblymember Donna Lopardo, the Chair of the Agriculture Committee, Assemblymember Dan O'Donnell, the Chair of the Tourism, Parks, Arts, and Sports Development Committee. We're also joined with Assemblymember Judy Griffin and Assemblymember Demond Meeks, Assemblymember Christopher Tague, and Assemblymember Colin Schmidt.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to also say that the Senate designates Jessica Fowler as our recording secretary.
And the Assembly designates Michael Thomas as recording secretary.
Thank you. The following agencies are at our table: the Adirondack Park Agency, the Department of Agriculture and Markets, the Department of Environmental Conservation, Office of Parks, Recreation, and Historic Preservation, the Olympic Regional Development Authority, the Energy Research and Development Authority, Department of Public Service, Division of Housing and Community Renewal, State of New York Mortgage Agency, Hudson River Park Greenway Communities Council, Hudson River Park Trust, and the New York Power Authority. In a moment, I will turn it over to Chair Englebright, but I do want to state that we're really excited for this year's budget and the possibilities it brings, certainly at the environmental table, but way beyond that. We are committed in the Senate to having a strengthened and continuing our protection of the environment through a funded Environmental Protection Fund. We want to make sure that important lines in that are funded. We also believe in the Senate that it is certainly worth reconsidering the Bond Act this year. We know at this exact time last year, we all committed to doing it. And now that we know that we don't have to use that $3 billion to borrow to pay state expenses, the economic benefits and the environmental and resiliency benefits, especially in terms of climate change, are just tremendous. But there are so many areas where we want to make sure that we are spending wisely on behalf of the public, including in water quality infrastructure, and so many other areas. So I'm very excited for these discussions with Co-Chair Englebright. When I was an assembly member, I got to serve on his committee, consider him a mentor, and gotten to learn alongside him so much of my time here, and look forward to this being a really productive budget on behalf of our state's environment, its natural resources, and all of its citizens.
Thank you for those kind comments, Senator. You are a pleasure and an honor, really, to work with. And you and your colleagues in the Senate give us a tremendous amount of perspective that is useful and balances the work that we do in the Assembly. But overall, it is just heartening to have a chance to work with so many people on the Senate side who are high quality and capability. I'm very pleased to be here today with not only my Senate colleagues, but the Assembly colleagues as we tackle the important work that's before us. I'm going to keep my comments brief, but I do want to provide some context for the Assembly's environmental budget. I'm delighted to report that this year the Assembly budget increases funding for the Environmental Protection Fund to $400 million. It's been, as you know, at the $300 million level for a number of years. And so we're proposing a 25% increase, and there's a great need for that. The EPF helps to make our communities places where people want to live and work, by safeguarding our drinking water, our clean air, our parks, municipal recycling projects, and open spaces. The fund also helps to reduce pollution and attract tourism and businesses to New York. And this fund is also important in addressing climate change. The $500 million in water infrastructure funding contained in the assembly budget will also help stimulate the economy and create good paying jobs across New York State. Access to clean and safe drinking water is the linchpin, not only for human health, but also for economic health. I've always felt that the budget should contain a limited amount of non-fiscal policy. And I think that the legislative process, with its built-in opportunity for public participation, rather than the budget, is the ideal venue in which to address important environmental issues. I'm looking forward to working with you, Senator Kaminsky, and your colleagues on the Senate side, and indeed everyone who's here from both the Assembly and the Senate to address all of these issues. And I'd like to toss it back to you. I know that some of your members would probably like to have an opportunity, along with yourself, to make opening statements, and perhaps we can have a chance to hear those thoughts. And then some of my colleagues in the Assembly also will have some thoughts that they'd like to share.
Thank you so much, Chair Engelbreit. I'll turn it over for brief comments to Senator Michelle Hinchey.
Hi, thank you very much. I'm really excited about this year's proposed budget. New York is an ag state, and I think what we've seen, and it's exciting to see that everyone has really understood and started to realize how important agriculture is to our state, seeing the supply chains break down and really recognizing how important it is to have locally sourced healthy food, both to support our upstate farmers, as well as making sure that we can eradicate food insecurity and that everyone across our state has access to the food that they need and deserve to eat. So I'm incredibly excited about this budget, excited to work with all of my colleagues to make sure that we can keep our agriculture as robust as possible.
Thank you, Chair Engelbreit.
I wonder if Steve Sibrowicz would like to make some comments. As you know, Steve Sibrowicz is the chair of our Housing Committee.
Yes, thank you, Chairman. To both chairs, to my colleagues in the Senate and the Assembly, and to my housing counterpart in the Senate, Brian Kavanaugh. The Assembly's budget proposal reflects the Housing Committee's long-standing commitment to one of our most fundamental needs, common to families in every community, affordable housing. Throughout the budget process, we will continue to prioritize the enormous capital need of NYCHA and public housing authorities across the state. We have added capital funding for NYCHA and other housing authorities, which are our last sources of truly affordable housing. At the request of the speaker, several majority committee chairs worked together to develop recommendations for the federal rent relief funding. Access for all New Yorkers is essential, particularly for those who are ineligible for federal aid, undocumented, non-native English speakers, or those who have limited access to technology. Also, we need to ensure that funds are distributed quickly and efficiently. While eviction moratoriums have temporarily averted the immediate danger of mass displacement, rental arrears continue to grow, putting tenants at risk of losing their homes when protections lapse, and negatively impacting the ability of property owners to maintain buildings, pay employees, and meet tax and mortgage obligations. Relief for homeowners and small landlords continue to be a priority. In addition to mortgage relief funding, the Assembly included $20 million in Homeowner Protection Program, or HOP money, to ensure that this critical program can continue to operate as we stand on the precipice of another foreclosure crisis. In addition, to ensure that affordable and supportive housing developers can continue to meet the housing needs of New Yorkers in the coming years, the Assembly added Article 7 language to require the governor to submit a five-year capital plan for affordable housing next year. As we reach the close of our current five-year plan, there is growing uncertainty among developers about the future of projects still in conception and in the pipeline. A multi-year commitment by the state is necessary to continue the pipeline of affordable housing projects, which can take 2 to 3 years or more of planning and approval. It is the committee's priority to ensure the final budget agreement has the end results of helping every New Yorker find and keep a safe, affordable home. Chairman, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Chair Kamensky.
Thank you very much. And for the record, since this is an environmental committee, Assemblyman Simmer, which the only pipelines we'll be supporting here are the pipelines in support of affordable housing, or the pipeline of coming affordable housing. I turn this over to Senator Brian Kavanaugh.
Thank you very much, Chair Kaminsky, and all of my colleagues, and particularly my counterpart in the Assembly, Chairman Sibrowitz. And also I want to acknowledge Senator Helming, who's the ranking member of our Housing Committee. I'm here as the Housing Chair, but also very pleased to be with this group that's going to work through the issues of the environment and energy and agriculture. It really is a terrific group, and I share a very strong commitment with many of the members here to those to funding those needs. As my colleague Steve Simberwitz mentioned, this really has been a budget that is coming out in an unprecedented time. We have taken extraordinary steps to make sure that people do not lose their homes during the COVID-19 pandemic as a result of the economic shutdown and the economic hardship that's come with that. We have a moratorium not only on residential evictions, but also on foreclosures, residential foreclosures in place. We did that legislatively after about 9 months of administrative orders and executive orders. We did that through legislation that was passed, and that's now in effect through May 1st. I think we will need to be reviewing whether that needs to be extended in the near future. But in the meantime, we're dealing with the other half of that equation, which is figuring out how to undo the enormous economic cost of that. I'm very proud that both houses have put forth a very robust package of relief for renters and for homeowners using federal money that many of us advocated for the federal government to provide. And in two very recent federal actions, we now have very substantial amounts of money. The Senate proposal for housing overall, by my count, although many of these pieces are across different budget areas, is about $5.5 billion that we would be investing in affordable housing in New York State. That includes about $2.7 billion for that COVID emergency rental assistance program. It includes a new and innovative program to convert underused hotels into affordable housing that has been developed in coordination with our Deputy Majority Leader, Mike Gianaris. Some of the stuff, as I mentioned, does cut across other tables, but we are putting forth in the housing budget a very substantial new program to provide permanent housing for homeless families and individuals called the Housing Access Voucher Program. It's actually something I've worked closely with Assemblymember Simberwitz on, and proposing to fund that in the initial year at $200 million. We're also taking steps to improve the existing homeless eviction prevention supplement programs that have been the most effective way that the city of New York in particular has kept people out of shelters and in permanent housing. Our funding for that would be a total, would bring the state total to $627 million. And also, as I mentioned, changing the program to make it more effective. Both houses are offering very large support for public housing. All told, on the Senate side, we're proposing over $1 billion of new investment in public housing. We're also fully funding the Homeowners Protection Program at $20 million. It's long past time that we stop using that as a sort of budgetary football during this process and just admit that that's an essential program, especially in a year where so many homeowners are facing the instability of potential foreclosures on taxes as well as mortgages. On taxes, we are also putting in a provision to reduce the rate of interest on unpaid taxes, which should help a lot of homeowners. That is at a different table. And we have a $200 million homeowner assistance fund that we've added. And we're reinvesting in our longer term capital efforts, $186 million for a new supportive housing as part of that, part of a 15-year commitment to get 20,000 units online. We are expanding for the first time in a while, or proposing to, I should say, the neighborhood preservation and rural preservation programs, expanding for the funding for that and making sure that every area where that kind of program is warranted is properly funded. And we are also funding, putting some new funds in for local code enforcement of housing, fire, and building safety codes. That's pursuant to a investigation and a report done by the Housing Committee and Investigations Committee that found our localities really are lacking often in the resources necessary to enforce those critical codes for health and safety. So again, I'm very pleased to be joining this group, and hopefully we can make rapid progress toward an adopted budget that really does address all of our housing and homelessness needs. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Chair Engelbrecht.
Thank you, Chair Kaminsky. I'd like to ask Donna Lopardo, our chair of the Agriculture Committee, if she might like to offer some thoughts as well. Donna.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Thank you, everybody. It's nice to see everyone. I guess the short story is that we owe a great deal to the people who produce our food and who process our food and get it to market. And certainly we're in a position now to make significant investments in the programs and services that these folks rely on. I think it's this one thing that the pandemic has revealed is that we have a lot of vulnerabilities in our food supply chain. And if there's a silver lining, I suppose, in this pandemic is that people are certainly far more aware of where their food comes from and who grows it and how it gets to their tables and to their into their stores. So I'm excited to work with my Senate colleague, Senator Hinchey. We've had a really great working relationship so far, and our the ranking minority member, Mr. Tagg, is also on this as well. He has very important input into this conversation as well. So we're going to do our very best to make sure that research and development, education and outreach, agricultural initiatives that help with development for our farmers and processors, along with some new initiatives I think people are going to be very excited about, get advanced in this budget. It's a great opportunity to help us really build farming. They've needed attention, and I think we aim to give it to them and help them get a good start for a successful future. So thanks, everybody.
Thank you for those wonderful opening comments, Chair Lopardo. Chair Kaminsky.
Thank you. I recognize Senator Kevin Parker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it. And Chairman Engelbrecht and all of the members of the Assembly and the Senate chairs who I've had the honor of working with in our work groups. As Senator Kavanaugh indicated, this is a great group of people to work on. The issues that are reflected at this table are some of the most important in the entire state. Just like we saw in housing, in the area of energy and telecommunications, we saw a moratorium that we've now put in place, and then now that we have begun to extend, as again, the people in our great state are fighting for both their lives and their livelihoods in the context of this pandemic. We in this budget continue to put forward the need for us to move towards a clean energy economy. And you see some changes in the structure of our state government as it relates to the CLCPA and the work that we've done there, and to continue to be kind of consistent with that work in terms of making it easier for people to be engaged in sustainable energy and the clean energy economy here in the state of New York. And so looking forward to our conversations about how we move the state forward. We think it's important, not just in terms of our environment, but also because of our economy. Energy continues to be the sixth largest industry in the entire state of New York, and we need to get people back to work as soon as possible. And, you know, the clean energy economy is one of the ways that we're going to, in fact, do that, and finding ways to fast track some of these projects is, I think, is going to be really, really important. So looking forward to working with the members of this working group, and I throw it back to you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chairman Engelbrecht.
Thank you, Chair Kaminsky. I'd like to invite Assemblymember Daniel O'Donnell, the Chair of the Assembly Tourism, Parks, Arts, and Sports Development Committee, to offer some opening comments.
After all that, I will be brief in that, saying that among the problems in the pandemic have been the collapse of our cultural and arts institutions and the overuse of our open space and parks. And this budget will need to address those two things. The Assembly is committed to getting the arts and cultures back operating and running and employed. And we're also committed to making sure our open spaces are utilized correctly and people can enjoy being in the great outdoors. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair Kaminsky.
Thank you so much. I recognize Senator Pamela Helming, Ranker of the Housing Committee.
Thank you, Chairman Kaminsky, and happy St. Paddy's Day to everyone. Luck of the Irish to all of you. Chairman, I will be offering comments on behalf of the Republican minority on the areas of housing, agriculture, and the environment. Both majorities have put forth a budget proposal that spends vast amounts of money, including $7 to $8 million in new taxes, and creates a number of large and complex programs. I want to start on the housing side, and I want to compliment Senator Kavanaugh. Senator Kavanaugh, you have entertained so many questions from me on so many of these programs. I appreciate your thoughtfulness in your answers and your responses. I wanted to talk for a moment with the allocation of $250 million for the creation of the Housing Our Neighbors with Dignity program. This program is described, the intent is described to address homelessness by incentivizing the conversion of underutilized commercial properties in certain hotels into affordable housing. I think that's great. I applaud the efforts on the floor. I had questions that I addressed to Senator Krueger during the Rezo debate. She turned to Senator Gennaris because there's one problem I see with this program, and that's that it's limited to New York City. Listen, we have homelessness issues across the state of New York. We have vacant commercial buildings and hotels across the state of New York. We need to expand this program, and I encourage all of you to expand the language that's currently included in the budget proposals so that every area of the state can benefit from this program. On the COVID-19 Emergency Rental Assistance Program, oh, I want to go back, and Senator Gennaris, at least during the floor debate, and Senator Krueger responded in the positive that they would be willing to revisit this and expand throughout the state. On to the COVID-19 Emergency Rental Assistance Programs, this is one of the few programs that will provide assistance directly to landlords who have not been paid rent. The drawbacks I see with this program as it's currently designed is that it comes with strings attached. Any landlord who participates in this program, they are required to allow the tenant to remain in the rental unit for another year with no guarantee of being paid future rent. And they're not allowed to increase the rental rates. And that includes, you know, oftentimes the landlord isn't responsible for increases that they experience, whether they're related to maintenance, whether it's utility costs going up, or whether it's property taxes that increase. So I ask you to please take a look, revisit that, those strings, as I like to refer to them, that are attached to this program. I've heard from numerous homeowners associations from across the state of New York who are supportive of this bill. Their only problem is that, like I said, that they're asked to commit to these two requirements that just make it almost impossible for them to participate in the program. When it comes to residential options for New Yorkers with intellectual and developmental disabilities, I think there are opportunities to do better in the state budget. What I'm hearing from residential service providers is that they're expecting to face a reduction of nearly $240 million. To me, that's just absurd, right? This is an issue that needs to be addressed. We shouldn't be talking about making restorations for these programs. We should be talking about what more we can do to increase the resources to meet the needs of people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And the same holds true for the thousands of New Yorkers who rely on the consumer-directed personal attendant program. This program, it's a lifeline. It allows individuals to stay in their homes and their apartments and to live as independently as possible. Now, I've heard from numerous constituents and consumers of this program who are truly afraid that without additional support from the state of New York, they're going to be forced out of their homes and into nursing homes. We're not just facing challenges on the housing front. The areas of agriculture and the environment must also be addressed in a frank, fair, and meaningful way. During the pandemic, as Senator Hinchey pointed out, we were reminded of just how critical our farmers and agribusinesses are. We all know that agriculture is the number one economic driver in this state, and that farmers provide our families with nourishments, jobs, and they do so much more. The Republican Conference supports fully funding the statewide agricultural budget and making permanent the Nourish New York program. 2/3 of our farms were negatively impacted by the pandemic. We've all seen a dramatic increase in food insecurity, and we've seen a spike in the reliance on local food drives. Our farmers stepped up in a big way to help feed people in need. Throughout all of this, farmers continued to be proactive in protecting their employees and stopping the spread of the virus. We can help them now, either in the budget or outside the budget, especially as spring planting season begins, by prioritizing our farmers for vaccines and making permanent in the budget the requirement to pay overtime at the current 60 hours. In regard to the extended producer responsibility included in the Senate One House, I'm asking, Chairman Kaminsky, that we have a full and robust discussion about developing a statewide comprehensive solid waste management plan that works, that does more than drive waste from New York City up to upstate New York. There's no reason for this type of legislation to be done behind the closed doors within the context of the budget. The conversation deserves everyone's attention. However, if the intent is to push this forward through the budget, I beg you, I am imploring you to reach out and work with the farmers, particularly the local wine producers, to develop a revised plan. The current proposal is vague. It doesn't appear to actually solve the problem of recycling. Continuing on with the environment, we support the expansion of the Republican-led initiative for New York's historic clean water investment, and we support renewed funding for the Environmental Protection Fund. Both houses increase capital spending within DEC in their own ways. I call on you to prioritize the maximum amount of resources for the protection of our natural resources with an emphasis on protecting our water bodies that are a source of drinking water. In the Finger Lakes region, it is vitally important that every single lake receives the attention and the resources needed to address the growing concerns related to harmful algal blooms and other threats to water quality. In years past, we've seen the system of winners and losers through the grant program. Every single lake needs the resources. We've been in study mode for a number of years when it comes to lakes and the harmful algal blooms. In my opinion, it's time to take action and provide the funding needed to remedy the existing concerns and implement real measures to preserve and protect our lakes. In addition, funding must be made available to ensure that every water treatment plant has the proper filtration devices to filter out harmful toxins. I just have a difficult time believing that we haven't been able to provide the funding to make sure that every community is able to provide safe drinking water. Something as simple as providing the devices to filter out these harmful toxins, including those associated with blue-green algae, that really needs to happen. We also need to continue to support efforts to build resilient infrastructure and flood risk reduction. In so many areas of the state, we've seen people who are just continuing to suffer because of flooding. Many constituents in my district constantly live in the fear that the next flooding season will be the one that destroys their home. Finally, with regard to funding, we need to adjust the grant funding procedure so awards are fair, and smaller communities without a professional grant writer are not at a competitive disadvantage to larger cities, towns, and counties. With this budget, we have an opportunity, we truly do. We have an opportunity to work together and support the issues of everyday New Yorkers. However, without substantial changes, I fear this budget will amount to additional hardships and suffering especially for the middle class and our small local businesses and farmers. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Helming. Chair Engelbreit?
Thank you, Chair Kaminsky. I'd like to ask if Assemblymember Chris Haig would like to offer some thoughts at this point.
I sure would, Chairman Engelbreit, if that's okay.
Yes, please.
Thank you. First, I just want to say I appreciate each and every one of you and your efforts through this process. I also just want to give a shout out to Chairwoman Lopardo, Chairwoman Hinchey, and Ranker Senator Borrello. Hopefully the four of us are going to put together a great working relationship moving forward. And actually, Senator Hinchey and Senator Assemblywoman Lopardo, I've already had that relationship with. So I want to thank both of you. You know, one of the things that was brought up is, you know, our farms and agricultures have, you know, we found out how important they were. The problem is they've always been important. And unfortunately, it's the folks that don't understand how their food is produced or where it comes from that have never thought it was that important. So we must do a much better job educating the public, educating our own colleagues in both houses of where the food comes from and how it works. I want to talk about the majority's proposal to make Nourish New York permanent. Very laudable, something I support 100%. But the way that it was put together, it throws a lot of federal money at one aspect of our food insecurity problems without looking at the broader issues that have caused the problems in the first place. It's not enough to merely give food banks more money to buy food, which is easy, especially when it's someone else's money. The entire sector needs to be looked at, from agriculture to transportation to processing capacity. In our conference, we put together a program called the New York Food Insecurity Farm Resiliency and Rural Poverty Act. It was supported conference-wide. It would integrate Nourish New York into a broader $35.7 million effort to revitalize New York's agriculture. It would also strengthen the state's food supply chain, promote economic development, while also delivering New York agricultural products to those who need them. The funding is designed in the following areas: infrastructure improvements to farms and regional food bank facilities, cold storage equipment purchases by local food pantries and nonprofits, transportation equipment, including fuel cost reimbursements, personal service cost assistance, purchasing assistance for regional food banks to purchase New York agricultural goods, and grants to assist new farmers, veteran farmers, and most importantly, disabled persons who would like to either enter or remain on the farm in New York agriculture. I believe that through this effort, we can deliver true long-term help to our farms, to our food banks, and to those who depend on them on time and on budget. One other area, in at least in the Assembly One House budget, $4 million was taken out of the agritourism. Unfortunately, to me, that's a slap in the face to the rural upstate economy. And I'll give you an example. One of the smallest counties in New York State, my home county of Schoharie, you can attribute $35 to $50 million a year to our economy because of agriculture. And without this investment of just $4 million, it will give a big hit to agritourism and to promotion. So I'm pleading with those of you in the majority to rethink that $4 million. And actually, I don't think $4 million is enough, but we'll take the $4 million back if you're eager to give it. And lastly, one other area that I wanted to hit on, and correct me if I'm incorrect on this, but I think in the Senate's One House bill, it was not in the Assembly's One House bill. And Chairman Kaminsky, I believe it's your bill, an act to amend the environmental conservation law in relation to establishing the Extended Producer Responsibility Act. I would plead with you, Senator, to allow producers and the people on the ground doing the job to come in and talk and have a say in that bill. This would be very detrimental to upstate rural farmers that are not prepared to be able to comply with the language in the bill at this time. This bill would negatively impact businesses that sell dairy, wine, cider, other packaged goods, and forest products. So I would ask that, I know that there's a companion bill in the assembly that is not part of the budget, but I would ask us to slow down on this and get a little more input from the people on the ground. Again, like I said, our farmers in rural upstate New York are not prepared or ready to comply with this, and it would be very detrimental to their operations. Again, I want to thank you for the time to allow me to address the conference. Appreciate all of your hard work and what each and every one of you do, and I appreciate each of you. Thank you so much. St. Patrick's Day. Happy St. Patrick's Day to you all, and God bless. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Chair Kaminsky.
Thank you. Are there any final comments by any senators? Okay, hearing none, we're gonna wrap this up, at least on the Senate side. And let me just say for any public that's watching, of course, the senators have an important role in the budget, and we have to vote on it, and we are policymakers. But I do want to give a shout out to the hardworking staff. The people who are not elected on this Zoom right now are the ones who are going to spend day and night tolling on the details and the negotiations in this budget. We owe them a debt of gratitude. They certainly don't make a heck of a lot of money, but they serve an important role and they work their tails off on behalf of the people of the state of New York. So I look forward to doing this budget with all the parties involved, and want to let the staff know that we have your back and we appreciate all you do. Chair Engelbrecht.
Thank you, Chair Kaminsky. I just would like to offer the opportunity to our alternates to introduce themselves and offer their thoughts as well. Judy Griffin is at the top of that short list. There's only three. Judy, did you have any thoughts you'd like to share?
Right now, I, you know, just look forward to hearing all that we have heard today and listening more and, you know, really preparing the best budget we can put forth. I don't have any specific comments at this time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Raymond Meeks, did you have some thoughts you'd like to offer with?
Yes, I just want to, you know, speak to the housing is definitely something that I recognize as a human right. And, you know, the idea of converting some of the hotels into housing in New York City, that's a great idea. However, we do have some similar properties throughout upstate New York, including Rochester, New York. So we definitely look forward to how do we look at legislation that applies to New York City and also assure that it applies to some of the other cities throughout New York State. So we're something that I'm really, really passionate about. And I think that, you know, working together and putting our minds together, we can actually accomplish that. And as it relates to agriculture, we have challenges even with our school districts and school lunches. And I think that's a way that we can work together to assure that we're helping promote local produce as well as supporting our farmers and the environment. I mean, without the environment, what do we have? So I think we need to be intentional as it relates to, you know, fighting and advocating for resources for all these different programs. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblymember. Our final alternate is Colin Schmidt, and I wonder, Colin, if you would like to introduce yourself and add some thoughts and help close out our initial statement.
Absolutely. Thank you, Chairman. Assemblyman Schmidt from the Hudson Valley. I echo many of the comments of my colleague, Chris Tagg, for the Assembly Minority Conference. Also want to just reiterate a few points of particular importance as co-chair of the Assembly Minority Water Quality Task Force under environmental funding, including making sure that we continue to put a priority on responding to water crises that are impacting many communities across our state, responding to those crises and ensuring that we have the proper funding in place for any infrastructure improvements that are needed. Along with that, on the agricultural end, especially as we're looking at assistance to our farmers, there have been several different sectors within the agricultural sector that have been left out of certain federal funding during the ongoing COVID-19 crisis. So any finalized agreement, we have to make sure that any of those farms that might have been excluded from federal aid are not excluded going forward on the state level. And obviously on the housing, we always have robust debate in the assembly, and the Assembly Minority Conference looks forward to robustly having a strong exchange of ideas on those items and ensuring that all voices are heard, particularly those from upstate who are smaller landlords and have been suffering during the pandemic and have not gotten as much assistance as may have been discussed. They are certainly looking for some additional assistance, and we need to do everything we can do so that they can continue to pay their bills, pay their property taxes, and be functioning members of our economy here in upstate. So thank you for the opportunity to address everyone today.
Thank you, Assemblymember Schmidt. That concludes our opening remarks, Chair Kaminsky. I thank you for bringing your colleagues' thoughts to the fore. I think our public can see that there's a great deal of symmetry, some things still to be worked out, but a good deal of symmetry already that gives us a chance to be optimistic that as we go forward with the conference committee process, that we'll have an opportunity to really make some good policy as a part of our spending plan for this next year to improve the quality of life and the quality of the environment for all of the people of the state. I wonder if you had any final comments before we adjourn for today, Chair Kaminsky.
No, we have about 2 weeks and 9 hours to get a budget done, so let's go do it.
Very good. Thank you. Thanks to all of our colleagues. We'll close this opening session at this time and adjourn until a time to be determined that Chair Kaminsky and I will help announce. Thank you all.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.